born to support a world war. Redesigned as a world-class cruise liner, and then a maritime training vessel, the Texas Clipper is now at her final port of call. The bell ceremony signals the last change of watch for the Texas Clipper, as Texas Parks and Wildlife Department takes final command of her. Saved from being cut into scrap metal, it is soon to become an artificial reef, providing needed marine habitat and quality fishing and scuba diving for the people of Texas. But before there was a Texas Clipper, she was known as the Queens. In 1944, the war is now going the way of the Allies. There is a huge need to transport troops and weapons to the South Pacific for the fight against Japan. Answering that need is the Queens. She was destined to be a Texas ship from the beginning. Her hull was laid on March 2, 1944, the anniversary of Texas Independence Day. The Queens carried 47 officers and 512 enlisted men on its maiden voyage. Joe Edwards was one of them.
I was 17 years old and joined the Navy. I was just country boy. And after I took the boot training and all the things, when I went aboard, it just seemed like a second home to me. We traveled so much, different places. That's what really made it interesting.
She left Norfolk, Virginia, and went straight to Pearl Harbor, picking up troops and supplies and transporting them to all corners of the Pacific. One of the first places the Queens delivered troops was the island of Iwo Jima, site of one of the bloodiest battles of the Pacific War. Joe's duty was to pilot a personnel transport.
There were so many people killed there that they just couldn't take care of everything. And when we were unloading, you'd have to watch not to hit a body or something that's still floating around the edge of it. We had three doctors board our ship, and we took on a lot of the wounded people, and they brought them out, and the doctors helped with the hospital ship there. It took them a long time to get that island straight.
The Queens was commissioned near the war's end, so one of its most memorable duties was bringing thousands of troops home. When she was decommissioned, she quickly moved to her next life as the ex-Cambian. In 1947, the Queens was redesigned to carry both cargo and passengers by Henry Dreyfus, the man who designed the radium dial alarm clock, the Hoover upright, and the rotary dial telephone. This was to be a luxury ship with a country club style. Renamed the Excambian, it was one of the four aces, the first fully air-conditioned ships in the world. She embarked from New Jersey and traveled the Mediterranean on a six-week round-trip voyage. Fares started at $850.
It was considered back in the 1950s as one of the top-of-the-line luxury ships. It had some of the most elaborate staterooms that existed at the time. One of the cargo holds that we know of now was used as an actual swimming pool. Some of the best service was found on that ship.
Life was good and very comfortable aboard the Excambian until the birth of the transatlantic airplane. Now everyone wanted to fly, and the Excambian found herself out of business, but ready to move on to her next life as the Texas Clipper. The Texas Maritime Academy was now in command, making her an ocean-going campus to train cadets for the American Merchant Marine. Texas A&M University at Galveston took over the training program and painted her maroon and white, the only one like it in the world. One of the instructors on board was Dr. Stephen Curley.
For a dozen years, I sailed on board the ship as an English teacher. And for 10 weeks each summer we went out. And I suspect when you add up 10 weeks and multiply it by 12 years, you have an awfully long time. I was on board that ship probably longer than most of the Navy people were on board the Queen's.
The students took classes and worked hard learning how to command and care for the ship, and they traveled the world while doing it. The Texas Clipper went on 30 cruises, visiting ports in countries such as Uruguay, Greece, Peru, and Russia.
The Queen's never crossed the equator. The Texas Clipper crossed the line four times, and each time there was a ceremony when you would do things like put some noxious unguents from the galley on people's hair and shave them with a wooden razor and splash seawater on them to cleanse them. And they worked really, really hard. But there was a sense of fun in addition to that.
In 1988, Anne Sanborn, a former cadet, became captain of the Clipper, making her the first ever woman to be skipper of a deep-sea American merchant vessel. The Texas Clipper was more than a ship. She was a teacher.
Every ounce of that ship I loved. Ships are the biggest things built by human beings that move. And I think they move, they take care of us, and ultimately they move us in more ways than one.
Ships grow old, and the sea stays forever young. In 1996, after 52 years of service, the Clipper was retired, the oldest active ship in the entire American Merchant Marine. After sitting and rusting for 10 years, the Clipper was acquired by Texas Parks and Wildlife. It took a year to thoroughly clean the ship and prepare it as an artificial reef.
We've modified the hull for water circulation and diver access. Anything that could float off the ship or cause a marine hazard has been removed. This by far exceeds the amount of effort that's gone into any one particular reefing project.
Having received inspections and approvals from the U.S. Maritime Administration and the Environmental Protection Agency, the Clipper was now ready for her final voyage.
We towed the vessel out of the harbor. It was just a sense of elation for a lot of people, especially people who had served on the Texas Clipper traveling the world.
This last voyage was a short one, just 17 miles out from South Padre Island to her final home. She had not been on the open seas for over 12 years, but she did just fine and was ready the next morning. On November 17th, the anchor was dropped at the location of the Clipper's new home. The final few holes were cut for circulation of water and sea life. The flood valves were opened, and the last man on board was recovered.
We're watching the ship sink, and at that point you realize that you've got a 7,000 ton piece of metal there. It's just a huge sight to behold, and it wants to do what it wants to do. Once we were watching this thing go down, it was just very impressive. It was the largest thing I have seen happen, and certainly the largest thing I've had the privilege of working on.
After 63 years of floating on the world's oceans, the Texas Clipper is now at her final port of call.
this ship is going to be home to a new crew. It's the flora and fauna underneath the water. It's just as it was our ship, it's going to be theirs as well. I say, farewell Texas Clipper, farewell Excambian, farewell Queens. You did one heck of a job, and you're still doing it.